repairs all over. We need to keep things in order. We don't want people coming in to visit, I don't want them coming here with dirty bills. We need to keep y'all's house clean.
Amen.
Got two bays and three here now.
I'm calling right now to see if Brittany and Cody's here, home bedrooms. They're not? Okay, you've already talked to them, okay.
They'll need to come back some other day. They'll need to come back to get Luke to serve, but I've asked him to come serve, he don't do that.
He's just saying service first, or either.
Can't come serve, we're not gonna be.
Is that truck going up there?
Yeah, that's a low, yeah.
Okay, we got three babies here.
Two. The Winklers are not well, one of them's not well today, so.
Okay, y'all come on up, mama. Come on, babe. It'll be like, hey. Y'all don't run on us now. Cody and Brittany couldn't be here, again. Where's Mark, David? Where's Mark, David? Okay. Special talent, all ladies for me. These babies dedicated back to God, it's important to God. It's just not something I do, it's something that God is ordained by God, so very important. It's not their salvation, but we're dedicating to God, and we're putting a charge to the parents and a charge to the congregation, even though the congregation's small today. Dedication of children unto the Lord had its beginning in early Old Testament days. Hannah is an example. She came to the temple to pray for a son, and she promised God that if he would give her a man child, she would give him to the Lord all the days of his life. God gave her a son. She called his name Samuel, and she cared for him until he was old enough to return to full-time work in the temple. Then she gave him to the ministry to which he had been called by God. In this dedication, Hannah was joined by her husband, Elkanah. What they did was in recognition that their son was a gift from God. Amen?
Amen.
So Aaron and Demetrius are not the parents of this little boy, Marion, but they have assumed an awesome responsibility. I appreciate them caring enough about this child. Even though it's not theirs to take care of, because I feel like it's in good hands.
Yeah.
So, of course, John and LaSalle.
Baby Leo.
They come today to dedicate her also. We appreciate that. This dedication serves as an example. It is more than just an example. It is a pattern for all dedications of little children from that day to this. Deanna, LaSalle, Dimitri, and Aaron, this charge is Deanna. In presenting this child for dedication, you not only signify your faith in Christ and the Christian way of life, but you also indicate your desire that he or she would grow to know the Lord. Amen? And live that life that you live. You come with thanks in your heart for the little life which God has placed in your care. But in order for this dedication to be complete, it is necessary for you not only to thank God, but to say to him, we give back to thee, Lord, that which is really thine own. God gave you children to take care of. make of him or her, but in this case of him and her, what thou wilt. That's dedicated. Use him or her to thy eternal glory. Keep him and her in thy perfect will until the day that thou shalt take him and her to be with thyself. You can do nothing better than to put the child in God's hand. Only God knows what possibilities that are wrapped up in these little lives. Great vocation. Amen. He might be a preacher one day. She might be a Sunday school teacher or a missionary. I don't think we're going to be here that long, but while they're here. You know, there's nothing more important than you parents can do than to dedicate it to God in the presence of your family here. Talk about it. You have still another responsibility in addition to that of understanding or surrendering the child to God. Just as Moses was given back to his mother, Jochebed, to rear as a son of Pharaoh's daughter, so will this child be given back to you. We're not going to keep him. My wife's going to hold him. We're going to pray over him. We're going to give back to him. Just like when Jochebed gave up Moses, see? What happened? She got him back. So we want both of his children. And you know, I believe both of them are going to go to the rapture. But even if something happened, the Lord carried it. You will need to listen in prayer to know what God's instructions to you will be. You will need to pass on to the child the things that God tells you to teach them. You will need to be willing to do God's will when it comes, when it crosses your own will. That's talking about discipline. Well, they ain't too little to be whipped right now or discipline, maybe not. But sometimes we don't want to do that, but if we don't do it and we don't correct them and we don't lead them to Christ, sometimes these things cross our own will. Well, I don't have time to take them to a special service in the church. I don't, but we got to do everything we can to make sure our children don't let them be involved in anything. I've seen this destroy so many children. Their parents let them get involved in ball. It ain't nothing wrong with ball and sports and all that, but if it comes before God, then you took him back.
Yeah.
Or her back. So keep your priorities straight. You will need to pass on to this child things which God tells you to teach him and her. You will need to be willing to do God's will that crosses your own. You will need to be willing to surrender the child to whatever ministry. I hope both of these children, if we are here that long, are choose to be in some type of ministry. May choose for him or her in the years to come. Also, I want to charge the congregation, most of them up here, if you'll stand with me, as your brothers and sisters in Christ up here, when you stand with me, you're saying, I will pray for that child. Little Leah, little Jamaria, right? Jamaria. By standing, you pledge. How many of you are going to pray? And I'm already praying for them. You already should be. But not only pray for them, but pray for their parents. God will give them wisdom in raising them. Y'all know it's important. Most important job you have is teaching these children about Jesus.
Right.
And bring them to the house of God. Amen. So they don't wind up being somebody else having to bring them. You bring them. Every time it's appointed. Okay, let's dedicate one at a time. Let the ladies go first. You guys will come up, deacons. Anybody wants to come up, pray over these children. And I'm going to ask my deacons to surround them. Take you all. One of you take all of you lay your hands. We're going to dedicate this little girl back to God. Raise her up, Miss Teresa. Just kind of lift her up a little bit. Ain't she beautiful?
Yeah.
Glad she looks like a mama. God right now.
The name of Jesus, Lord, baby Leah
back to you, God. Her mom and dad brought her to you, God. They can surrender. We want to give her back to you, God. We ask you right now, in the name of Jesus, you would take this child, God, and help her mom and dad, God, raise her to fear of God. Touch her mind. Cover her mind in the blood of Jesus Christ. Let your perfect will, let thy kingdom come, and thy will be done in her life. Thank you, God. We consider to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, little Jamario. grew to love those people over there and hope to see some of them in heaven tonight when we get there. But the missionary that we went with that was over there, Brother Ernie Jones, he passed away a few weeks ago. We're going to do this in memory of him, not for him, but just in his memory.
Yeah.
But I want everybody in here to understand that my vision and my dream for Senegal, those two churches, is my dream. It's also God's dream.
Amen.
He has spoken to me this week and challenged me to challenge you.
Yeah, come on.
My people, Hope House, to catch a hold of this dream. Let me explain again. I mentioned in Sunday school what a faith promise is. A lot of people don't understand what a faith promise is. Faith promise is what I want to ask you to do at the end of the service is to take one of these little pieces of paper down here. Nobody's ever going to come to you and say, you didn't do your faith promise. That's not going to happen. This is between you and God. But I know the Lord has spoken to me. I felt all morning like I'd go have a heart attack. It's a load. I don't really know what's going on, why it's, maybe it's just something urgent. I don't even realize about the situation. But we have two churches over there, big churches that are meeting outside in the heat. They don't have a roof over their head. They don't have a foundation to stand on. They're meeting outside. Y'all understand what we're talking about.
Yeah.
And these two tabernacles are male building roofs. And a cement slab, what we'll do, we don't do it one way or the other.
Come on,
I just feel like we want God's challenge me to do it. And I told him if I got to sell something to do it, I'll do it. That's just the way I feel. It's that strong to me. And I do love missions, and I do love missionaries. That man, Ernie Jones, one of the most, one of my heroes, you know, what he give up 50 years of his life. I say give up. That's what God called him to do.
Yeah.
Some people think I'm giving up my life to do what I'm doing. But Brother Ernie Jones was a committed man of God. He spent many days in my home, came to visit, stayed with us on several occasions. And we're going to do this in his memory. But what I want you to understand about a faith promise, is what Miss Daisy and what the choir just sang about. I don't know how you do that. But a faith promise is that God will do something you don't think he can do.
That's right.
It's not what you can do, it's what he can do through you.
Yeah.
And you do a faith promise, whatever that is. We need $10,000 by November the 1st. I'm going to call the man tomorrow, the missionary, and call him and tell him what we decided. I've already decided. I hope that everybody in this place, the ones that are not here, I don't maybe it wasn't meant for them to be here, but I know it was meant for you to be here. Everybody in this building today has an opportunity to see a dream fulfilled, a vision for the people of these two churches. They need us.
Amen.
I told my wife, it's almost like I can hear them saying, come help us. We need help. So Paul experienced that. In Acts chapter 16, Paul had a vision, that a man from Macedonia that he didn't know. He didn't know anything about this man. He was saying, come help us.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Come help us. We need the gospel. And Paul went. He was obedient to that vision. And because he went, there was a church founded in Macedonia.
Right.
And Macedonia began to help other churches. Just like, come on, man.
Right.
Now, we've been helped, Hope House.
That's right.
Yeah.
Hope House, if there's a church in Jackson County that's been blessed by other people that have given,
then
you wouldn't be here today.
Obviously.
But because other churches, when we first started this thing, let me help you understand, we didn't have any money. I was broke. But other churches caught the vision of what we wanted to do, reach out to children in this area, and they started giving us money.
Amen.
In one particular service, a church had faith promises of $32,000 in one service. They took up faith promise pledges from a church in this area that pledged $32,000 to Hope House.
Wow.
To a bunch of people, they didn't know. They knew me and my wife. Some of them did, some of them didn't even know us. But they pledged $32,000 over a year. They had a year to do that. And it came in. Thank God it did.
Amen.
Other churches in this area, some of that we've had churches come from Kentucky. Kentucky, Tennessee. That rebuilt this floor. We had two churches. One in Tennessee, one in Kentucky. Y'all may not remember this. Several years ago came in and helped us read. The floor was rotten. It was falling apart. Yeah. They tore the floor. They said, what can we do? Baptist people.
Yeah.
What can we do? They came and spent a week, I think it was. We didn't pay them. They paid us. They bought the materials.
Yeah.
They came because they saw a need.
Amen.
Amen.
Come on,
and it's been, I can just maintain that after Hurricane Katrina hit, the church gave us, sent $2,000, my brother's church, sent me a check, just knew we had a problem back there. Handed me $2,000 to fix that room back there that was underwater. So people have done what God's asking us to do.
Yeah.
God spoke to them, just like I hope He's spoken to all of you.
Amen.
This thing in Senegal is two churches, two metal buildings on two slabs that'll seat hundreds of people, okay? And I've heard, this is what I've heard all week, and I don't know how many of y'all ever saw a movie, Field of Dreams. It's a movie. It's old, about 25 years old. But as God began to speak to me, I started remembering this movie. Because what I'm hearing from God is if you build it, if Hope House will build it, they
come
will
on,
come.
Man. That's
they
right. Come. That's right. Amen.
Woo,
come on, say it one more time, Brother Gary.
If we build,
yeah.
If we'll help these people, not only the people that are there are going to have a roof over their head and not be standing in mud,
yeah.
But there's going to be other people that's going to come.
Amen.
And get saved.
Amen.
I think y'all like to be part of
that.
What we pay $10,000, what we pay, that's a lot of money. That ain't nothing to God.
That's right.
And that should be a whole lot to us.
Yeah.
I personally don't think it's going to take a whole lot of faith. But that's what God's asking us to do. And He's asking all of us to share the burden.
Yeah.
Not one or two of us. Most of us waste more money. Come on now.
Yeah.
Right.
I'm going to tell you. Their income over there, Brother Bilbo, is about $30 a week.
Yeah.
That's what they live on. To them, we're rich people.
Yeah.
That's why Mexicans want to come to America. I've been to Mexico. I've seen what they got. Nothing.
Yeah.
I've been to Guatemala. They ain't got nothing. They live in huts.
Yeah.
I told Brother Bilbo a while ago, he's got a dream of going on a mission trip. I said, When you go, you're going to come back a different man.
That's the way
it changed my life because I realized how spoiled I was. That's to God, Guatemala and to these people in Africa. Most of the world, folks, we don't realize because we ain't never been there, we don't see it. Most of the world is either at poverty or below poverty.
Yeah.
We, compared to them, Miss Elise, are rich.
Yeah,
that's right.
We are wealthy people, and God speaks about that. He speaks to us that we have, you know, there's things we want that we don't necessarily need. There's a lot of things I'd like to have a new Silverado, but I don't need
one.
I just, and I'm, you know, we're spoiled in this country. And I'm not fussing at nobody because you people in here give.
Yeah.
You give, you pay your tithes, some of you give permission. But what I'm asking for, what God's asking for, is for you to fulfill His dream.
Amen.
This is God's dream. It's those people over there in Africa, they have a dream. This missionary shared it with me. They're walking around in mud when it rained. They out in the sun when it's 120 degrees. Think about that if we had to worship outside every Sunday. That's what they have to do. That's what I want to share with this. In a faith promise, if not, God, I'm going to get this. Let me sit down and figure this out. I got to pay. A faith promise is God's going to speak to you and tell you what to give.
Amen.
He's going to lay it on your heart.
Amen.
And it's going to be more than you think you can.
Come on.
Because if you can do it yourself, it ain't a faith promise.
Yeah.
I've been involved in this before, and I've seen God work. Look, let me tell you something. This building was given to us because we gave to God.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to tell anybody in this room that if you give to this, and you really do a good thing, God will give you a new house next week. Or we're going to get a new building. I'm not going to tell you we're going to get a new building. That ain't what I'm asking for. But I can tell you from experience, when you give to mission,
come on now.
When you give to mission, God pours out. He blesses us when we pay tithes.
Right.
But when you give to mission, then you give above your mission. I'm a 20% guy. I believe we ought to give 10% to tithe, which is his anyway, and we ought to give another 10 to
an offering.
Oh, God. That's why people don't want to come to church. That's a big reason. I know some people right now that don't go to church because they know if they go, they're going to be obligated to support the church and their tithes and offerings. And they are. I said they are.
Amen.
Two of y'all believe that.
Amen.
You're obligated to go where you go to church and pay your tithes and support the church. But we're also, God has asked us in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, God said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel.
Right.
Now, we can't go to Africa.
Yeah.
You may not ever see Africa. I have. I believe that one of the reasons God let me see it, because he knew one day I was going to be pastoring a bunch of black folks. I don't know. But I can promise you, whether you ever get to see Africa or not, one of these days you're going to see them people over there in another world.
Yeah.
And they don't know what we did for them. Now, we're not doing this to get pat on the back. We're doing this to see people get saved and miss heaven.
Amen.
You know, 5 minutes of preaching in Africa will do more than 5 hours of preaching in Texas.
Yes, it will.
They receive it.
Yeah.
5 minutes of preaching in Mexico or Guatemala will do 10 times more than what you can do here, because we're gospel heart.
Amen.
America's gospel heart. But those people down there are hungry. They hungry, they poor, they ain't got nothing. That's why I'm not for letting people cross the border without some checks and balances, but I am for if they come and for the right reason and they want to come make a living and support this country and be I'm for it.
Yeah.
I ain't for just letting them.
Yeah.
Okay? So this is what faith promise is before I preach. You pledge. Hopefully, you've already been praying.
Yeah.
Amen.
Like I said, most of us throw more money away in a year. If all of us put what we throw away in a year together, we'd have more than $10,000.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
When you say throw away, what you mean, brother? It's anything. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I do.
Yeah.
We all throw money away on things that don't matter. That car ain't gonna matter in eternity.
No, it's not.
That house,
that
whatever, ball game,
them
new shoes that everybody else is wearing, that ain't gonna matter.
No, it won't.
It's life to have, and I ain't against that stuff, believe me. I got a nice pair of $30 dress shoes. Nothing wrong with that. But what about the need? We've been presented with a need.
Yeah.
Okay? Paul told the church at Philippi, he said, you were the only church. Now, when I read this, I think about Little Hope House. This church, Brother Martinez, was presented with a need in Macedonia and in Paul's life. But the only church that responded to the need was the church at Philippi. And he commended them for it. He said, not only did you give, but you gave with a willing heart. Now, I challenge you today. Some of you already look like you're ready to go. That's all right. If you need to go, go. But let me tell you something. My challenge for you today is not to give because Brother Gary would be proud of you. Because you don't have to sign your name. Or that somebody will say, oh, look at Hope House. But you give willingly, of a willing heart, because you want to see these people in hope in Africa minister to.
Yeah.
Amen. They have a need. Amen. They're saying they don't know about hope pipes.
Yeah.
But some of them do.
Yeah.
Brother Ernie. But they don't know us. But one of these days. See, I had a dream, a vision a while back. I shared it with y'all. It was real. I was in heaven. Walked up, man, it's beautiful. I walked up and all of a sudden these kids, black, white, Mexican, started coming up, grabbing hold of my robe. I don't robe. And they said, thank you. Thank you for what? And it's like, I knew what they were talking about. Thank you. I fell on the ground in heaven. I started crying, weeping to God. Just broken by the love and the they wanted to just thank me for being part of helping them get saved.
Amen.
And I was, as I was weeping and had my face down, 2 feet stood in front of them.
That's right.
They had holes in them, big old holes. See, Jesus still got them holes in his feet.
Yeah.
He wasn't bleeding or anything, but I looked down, Lander, and there was 2 feet in front of them. Know who it was?
Jesus.
Now, y'all can believe that or not, it happened to me.
Amen.
But what I want us to catch a vision of today is there's a need in Son of God.
Amen.
And they're saying, help, but we need help. The Hope House, according to the missionary, they're having trouble getting people to support this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
People just don't give anymore like they used to.
Yeah.
They don't, there ain't no such thing as faith. Y'all know how many faith promised churches there are that even do this anymore? I don't know of any. But when I was in church, when I got saved, I used to hear about it all the time. We don't give permissions. My wife and I, one of the first things we did, we really got saved. We were challenging that little church to build a church in Costa Rica. We could build a church for $2,000, the whole thing, out of block. It wasn't like this. We played. I just felt God wanted me to do it. I didn't know nothing about Costa Rica. But guess what happened? They gave us a year. It was a year thing. So we played to do that, and we did. We didn't pay no more back. But then when we needed a building,
yeah.
Come on.
When Hope House needed a building, guess what happened? It was given to her. Not $2,000, not $20,000, not $100,000. You know, well, this place ain't worth $150,000. That's what this building appraises for. The property, this got the property. But see, we were given a building.
Yeah.
I believe it was because that little seed we planted of faith 40 years, 39 years ago. I'm giving you this. To this church, now when I didn't know I was going to be called preach. This was in 1979. Some of y'all wasn't born, most of y'all wasn't born then. What do you thought of?
No.
But what I'm trying to tell you is your pledge today, you're going to, when you pledge this to God, listen now, you pledge it to God, don't go to sleep on it.
That's right.
We're pledging to God that by November the 1st, Lord, we want to have $10,000 or maybe send us some at a time. I don't know. But by November the 1st, he gave us 6 months. He said, they need it now. But could you do it in 6 months?
Come on.
Can we do it, Walter?
Yeah, come on.
Can we? Is it impossible? With you and me, it is, but not with God.
That's right.
Amen. We need $10,000. So don't look at me now frowning. I'm not going to be mad at you if you don't give. Turn in your Bibles to me.
Hey, God.
Chapter 1. Hard little book of Bible. Always. Have trouble finding it. This ain't 2 or 3 pages. 2 pages. Hey, guys. When you get it, say amen. Chapter 1. Right before Zechariah and Malachi,
amen.
right toward the end of the Old Testament. Stand to your feet. Hey, God, chapter 1, verse, start with verse 5. There's a unique thing about this. I shared it with you tonight. If you want to hear, I'll share it again. Verse number 5. Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Consider your ways. What are you doing? I heard somebody say, I ain't doing nothing in church, and they still ain't doing nothing. They keep saying, I want to get involved, and then they told my wife, we ain't doing nothing. So evidently it's bothering them, but still ain't doing nothing. He said, consider your way. Consider what your priorities are in life. Are y'all listening to me? Yes. What's your priority? Yes. The kingdom, heaven. Ye have so much and bring in little. You eat, but you have not enough. You drink, but you're not filled with drink. You clothe, but there's none warm. Now God's getting on Israel here. And he that earneth wages to put into a bag with holes. Some of us, the reason we can't never get ahead,
come on now,
because we ain't tithing, number one, and then number two, we ain't giving no offering. Because I'm going to tell you something, I'm a witness to this, old pal. If you give to God, you ain't going to have to worry about your needs getting met.
Amen.
I didn't say your wants, I said your needs will get met. And that's where we get messed up. We get our needs confused with our wants.
That's right.
Our needs are Africa's wants.
Yeah.
They need it and they want it, but our wants are Africa's needs, is what I would say. Thus saith the Lord of hosts. I done read that. Go up to the mountain and bring wood and build the house. Go up, this is the scripture that been on my heart all week. Go up to the mountain, bring wood, build the house, and I will take pleasure in it, and I will be glorified, saith the Lord. God wants to be glorified.
Yeah.
If these people get these two buildings, guess who's going to get the glory for it? God. I don't want the glory.
Amen.
But God's going to get the glory. Why, them people going to be shouting off, I'd like to be there that first week they get to go in them buildings.
Amen.
And I know what Africans, I know how they worship.
Yeah.
They've been doing the Jericho March. They've been shouting all over the place.
Amen.
Y'all like to be part of that?
Amen.
I have been. I hope most happiest, most fulfilled times in my life is when I've been involved in ministry and missions. We don't know them people, Brother Jeff. That's right, you don't. Verse 14 says, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel. I'm hoping our spirits get stirred today. The son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, the son of Jozadak, the high priest, and the spirit of all the remnant. Y'all see that? The remnant. Only a remnant got involved in this.
Yeah.
Of the people, and they came and did work in the house of the Lord of hosts, their God, in the 24th day of the 6th month, in the 2nd year of Darius, the king. You can be seated. I want you to understand that on April the 25th of 2017, somebody was here the other night and heard this, but on April the 25th of this year, last week, Brother Rodney Coleman called me. He and I went to Africa together and built an auditorium. Whatever. Got pictures of it up here. On April the 25th, Brother Rodney was stolen, really, when he called me. He said, Brother Gary, I had called him the other day, and I said, Brother Rodney, that scripture that we heard, I could hear the word, but I couldn't remember where it was at. He said, this scripture, he said, I got it marked in my Bible. The day he called me and gave it to me, what I just read was April the 25th. And on April the 25th in 1993, are y'all listening to me?
Wow.
Exactly 24 years later to the day, Don Tucker, the man over the missions in Africa, preached the message to us to go to Africa.
Wow. Yeah.
Well, that's just an accident, I guess. But one of those things that confirms me when God started dealing with me, he showed me this. Brother Rodney said, Brother Gary, I got this mark. And today is the 25th April. Wow. He said, on April 25th, about 24 years ago, same day, isn't that odd? How God confirmed. Y'all think that's a confirmation?
Yes.
I know it is to me. So 24 years to that day, God preached this word through Donald Tucker. What does that mean to us? In John chapter 4, verse 35, if you'll turn with me to John chapter 4. Sometimes we hear God's word and say, well, that's for somebody else. That's the problem in the church today. That's why nothing gets done for the most part. That's why we don't have churches don't have bus ministry anymore.
Yeah.
John 4:35 says, say ye not there yet 4 months. Jesus is talking. Then cometh the harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields.
Yeah.
Field of dreams. There are people out there in this community that we're reaching out to.
Yeah.
They got a dream, Brother Bilbo. I saw them here up here on this altar a few weeks ago when this during the revival when Brother Ryan preached and he asked those kids to bring their dreams and their desires up here and lay them on the altar, write it down. I read them. I wept over them. I got them home in my study. My wife had laid them in front of me and I started reading. It broke. It absolutely broke. Now they come in here, you don't see that. You don't see what they wrote. It's like they're trying to hide. They don't want us to know what's going on at home. But they wrote it. And I wept. You know what it basically said? I have a dream that I get out of this hell I'm living in. They're living in a nightmare. Some of them are.
Yeah.
Not all of them. Some of them. Most of them. They're living in a nightmare, Brother Darcy. You know what I'm talking about. Your life before you came to Jesus, what was it? From what I've heard, it's a nightmare. It was a nightmare.
Amen.
But deep down inside there, you had a dream, didn't you? It'll get better.
Praise the Lord.
Hello? I did
praise
too.
Praise the Lord, man.
I think most of us in here, some of us in there, maybe some of y'all is going to watch this on the internet. Your life was a nightmare. Mine was a nightmare. It's going to be a reality because I'm going to wake up in hell.
Yeah.
That's the ultimate nightmare. We're headed to hell. Our life would have wound up a nightmare in hell if it had not been for Jesus Christ. Some of us lived a nightmare before we got saved.
Yeah.
Your life was a nightmare. Cussing and drinking and pornography.
That's right.
Yeah.
Screaming and hollering all the time. That's what I heard in these.
Yeah.
These kids, they wrote it down. They didn't sign it. I don't know who did what. All I know is I heard some dreams. Some dreams. They're living in the cotton field right now. Some of them.
Yeah.
It's the field of nightmares. Hello, anybody relate to that?
Yeah.
Your life, my life was a field of nightmares. I mean, I used to have nightmares before I got saved all the time. And it was because I was so mean and those things inside of me, I'd have horrible nightmares. I don't have any nightmares anymore.
Amen.
But God rescued
me. Amen.
Come on now.
God rescued. You know, Martin Luther King had a dream. Matter of fact, one of his message, I think he laughed and said, I have a dream. You know what he did? He gave his life for that dream. He got killed.
Yes, yeah.
You know, Martin Luther King had a dream. He wanted to see black folks equality. Have the same opportunity. You know, if it hadn't been for Martin Luther King, what would it be like?
Yeah.
I don't even know if Martin Luther King was Christian or not. I've heard both. But the fact is, Martin Luther King had a dream.
Yeah.
Had a dream. These kids come in on this bus. They have. I ain't just talking about Africa today. I'm talking about these kids we bring. I'm talking about people that you know out there you work with. They are living in a nightmare.
Yeah.
They just wish. They might not even tell you. Sometimes they'll write it down. Like these kids. I will tell you. I challenge some of them to come and read these things that they wrote. It'll make you think twice where you want. look at them.
Yeah.
We don't want to stink.
Yeah.
Some of you do because you used to be there. I have a dream.
Amen.
God got a dream. Y'all hear me?
Amen.
God has a dream so strong that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever should believe upon him should not perish.
That's right.
But have everlasting life. That's God's dream.
Amen.
Jesus fulfilled that dream by coming and performing. He lived a nightmare.
Yes.
Jesus went through a nightmare so the Father's dream could be a reality. Y'all
yeah, that's right.
Yep.
The question is, these people over here in Africa and these children we reach out to, will their nightmare continue?
Yeah.
Or will it be dream fulfilled?
Yeah.
Fields are white. Jesus said, lift up your eyes and look on the fields. Well, they are white already. They're white now. They're whiter than they've ever been, Hope House. I had a dream the other night. I hadn't figured out yet what it meant to let somebody in here can interpret. It was the weirdest dream. I dreamed me and my wife went to a car dealer. We don't need a car.
Yeah.
Listen to this. They're going to bring a car around to us, Miss Erin. Let us get in and drive. And we get a car, beautiful pearl car. Y'all never seen it. That's the color I would want other than black. But it was a beautiful car. And the guy pulled around in the car and he parked. And he opened the door and said, y'all come on. Guess who was driving? Donald Trump. Donald Trump. And the pearl. Does that mean we're supposed to go for a ride? I don't know. It means something. Some of y'all have to figure it out. Donald Trump driving the car to pearl.
Yeah.
Y'all know what pearl is in the Bible, right?
Yeah.
We're pearl and we're going. I don't know. Y'all have to interpret that. Hello. God said to come and get his pearls. At the last. Maybe that don't mean nothing, but it does to me. Praise the Lord. Jesus said in John chapter 4, listen to this, I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day, because the night coming when no man can work. Y'all hear that? He said, I must work.
Amen.
And he said, because the night is coming and it's here when no man's coming. The tribulation period is the night when no man will be able to work. When that trumpet sounds, Dimitri, our time for work is over. We got to do our work now before
right.
It gets dark, completely dark.
That's right.
The night coming, no man can work. God don't want anybody to perish. We've all lived in a nightmare, but God wants all of us. God's dream for you and me and everybody else is that we'll have a better life, an abundant life. Remember what Jesus said, I'll come that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly.
Amen.
All right. But we think that's just for Americans.
No.
Oh my.
Like I said a while ago, their scale standard of living is $30 a week. $30 a week. Ours is close to $750 a week.
Yeah.
That's average. $750. Most of them don't have enough. They have to really sparingly feed their children. They don't have cars. They got bicycles.
Yeah.
Their dream ain't a no Cadillac.
Yeah.
We're preaching the gospel today that if we'll just give, God will give us cash. Their dream is just to have a way to get to church. Their dream is just to have a roof over their head when they get there.
Yeah.
Hey, that's their dream. I hope I ain't making nobody feel guilty about what you got, because I got things. God's dream for us is told in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. God had a dream for us. Are y'all listening to Mr. Reese's favorite scripture? For I know, God said. And that word know there is a Hebrew word, yada. It means I love you and I know the thoughts that I have towards you.
Yes.
Are you listening? This is God talking to all of humanity. I know the thoughts that I have, that I think towards you. Don't God think about us all the time? He's thinking about them people over there in synagogue in the building.
Yeah.
He said, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end.
That's right.
That word expected end is the word Hebrew word tikvah. It means a hope that you'll have a hope of a better life. Not only a hope of a better life, Mr. David, but a hope of eternal life.
Yes, that's right.
There are people in Africa today, many of them. I think the population in Senegal is 15 million.
Wow.
Just in that city. Now, we ain't talking about Africa.
Wow.
15 million people in Africa, in Senegal.
Wow.
The poverty over there is off the chart. People are starving to death, being murdered, massacred. Brother Ernie witnessed a wholesale massacre. He saw bodies floating down the river from what was the name of that town where they had a murder? Went in there and slaughtered.
Rwanda.
And he witnessed bodies. There were so many bodies floating down the river that it plugged up the.
Yeah.
He witnessed that. This is why Brother Ernie was had such a vision. 50 years, think about that. He would come back to America, he was in culture shock.
Miserable.
He had so much here that he didn't have over there. And he saw people living in luxury over here while people over there starving to death. You go right across the land in Mexico, you can look in from Mexico across the border. You got cardboard huts right here. And right across, you can see skyscrapers.
And you wonder why.
Am I trying to get y'all to feel sorry for these people? Yeah. No, I'm trying to get you to have some passion.
Yeah.
Because I fear we're going to answer to God when we stand on judgment day. Whom much is given, much is required.
Yeah.
That's right.
That's not my words, in God's. Psalm 116, verse 12 said, what can I render unto the Lord for all of his benefits to me?
Yeah.
Anybody in here been blessed?
Amen.
Yes, amen.
Well, I ain't got no Cadillac yet. I said, I ain't never been blessed
amen.
To have
amen.
What you have.
Amen.
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 I got things I don't even have to have. I got a houseboat. I don't have to have no house. I told the Lord, I'll give you my houseboat. That's what I told him. Whatever I got, Lord, for us to meet this need, I'll give it to you. If you want it, all you got to do is put the finger on it.
Yeah.
That's the way we all ought to be. We got faith. I don't need no. I like it. I enjoy it a lot. I go down there almost every day and just spend some quiet time. Fish a little bit, but I just enjoy this quiet and nature.
Amen.
I love it, but I said, God, if you need it, I give it to you. You need my truck, you need my boat, whatever I got, my house, it's yours.
Yeah.
Right? God gave it to me. So God said in Psalm 116, David said, what can I give back to you, God, for all of your benefits unto me? What's a benefit? What do you have on your job? You got benefits.
Health
benefits. Some of them do. What you been blessed with, Brother Walton? You been blessed, ain't you? God wants you to give back.
Yeah.
Huh? Brother LaSalle, what you been blessed with?
Yeah.
The
avalanche. Whoa. You ain't got an avalanche. I like to have one of myself. I don't live, but I like to have one. Y'all all live in nice apartments and nice houses. I do.
Amen.
Amen. Somebody off shout.
Amen.
Glory to God! I got a roof over my head. I don't have to get wet when it rains. I've seen people living in huts. When it rains, rolling aside, they get wet. They have to crowd into a corner to keep the water from coming up on them while they try to eat their little beans that we took them and little Y'all can tell I'm hurt. God said he wants us to have respect in him. That word literally means he wants our dreams to come true.
Amen.
How many of us got a dream?
Yes, amen.
Okay, I want to see it. I want a better job. I want to make more money. That's wrong with that. As long as you don't give more to God.
Yes,
amen.
Amen.
I want to do more. I want to have more kids. That's good, as long as you don't dedicate them to God, Miss Young.
That's right. That's right.
Miss Aaron and Demetrius, I was just proud of y'all. Every time I looked at that baby, I know you can say, well, we just don't want to be bothered with that. I ain't going to tell you what I think of might make heads sweat.
Uh-oh.
But see, we ought to have the same feeling toward these people over here in Senegal. We don't know them.
Yeah.
They're brothers and sisters in Christ, and there's some out there that ain't saved yet. That are saved. He may not look. Come help us!
Yeah.
That's what that man told Paul. He said, come over here, Macedonia, and help us. Yeah. Paul didn't say, well, I ain't got time. Paul was a busy man.
Yes,
y'all hear me?
Amen.
He went. And guess what happened? A church was founded. Many people got saved. That church started supporting mission.
Come on now.
And he told that church in Philippi, he said, you were the only church. Y'all listening?
Yeah.
Yes.
You were the only ones that ministered to my needs. See, Paul didn't have no money either.
Yeah, yeah.
He was a missionary. He went from church to church to city, preaching the gospel. You know how he made his living? Well, he made tents. And he was a well-educated man. But he commended this church because they ministered not only to Macedonia, but they gave him some money. Some of them came up to his head, Brother Paul. I know you probably need some little extra.
Yeah.
That's right.
We, Miss Teresa and I, have had that happen to us 1,000 times. Y'all don't even know about it.
Amen.
And then people wouldn't want me to tell you. Sometimes we didn't know where the next pay it was going to come from, somebody comes to here.
That's how I go. Amen.
God told me, are we getting the mail?
Yeah.
Amen.
It felt like it did. He said, they were right.
Yeah.
But when God promised, when you do what you're supposed to do, he'll meet your needs according to his riches in glory.
That's right.
Now, we go out here and waste, and we just frown and throw money away like it was nothing.
Yeah.
Huh? Then we were whining, no, God, I didn't take care of my knee. Yeah, he did. You throw it away.
Yeah.
Oh.
Come on, brother.
We waste. We're going to be judged by what we waste, Hope Pal.
Yeah.
Come on.
Anybody believe that? You're going to stand before God either at the white throne judgment or at the beam of judgment. And you're going to give an account of your stewardship. Y'all remember that parable, right?
Yeah.
As it come, God said, come give an account of your stewardship, what you do with your money. Well, yeah. God, he ain't going to ask me. Yes, he is too. One of the most powerful messages I ever heard in my life, y'all listen to me, was at the time of Assembly of God from a mission, a preacher, an evangelist said, when the books are open, one of them going to be your checkbook.
Yeah.
Now, he preached that and it changed my life. He said, when you, now he didn't literally mean, but I believe it's going to be. It ain't necessary, but let me see your check, but it's going to be. He got it all recorded. Let me tell you something. Everything you do is recorded.
That's right.
If it's sin, and it ain't washed in the blood, you go into hell.
Yeah.
You go into hell.
That's right.
But our works and what we do with our money, your stewardship, are you faithful in your stewardship? Are you spending more on junk that you don't need? You can do without. I'm asking Hope Pals and God here today to do without a few things that you don't need. Brother, yeah, what you want me to do? I don't know. How many of you love God?
Amen.
How many of you want to help God? Somebody did read it.
Amen.
How many of you want to help God fulfill his dreams?
Amen.
He said, I wouldn't none perish. I would that all my people had a roof over their head, saith the Lord. I want my people to be able to go to worship at the house of God and be standing on some solid ground instead of mud. I've been over there, Hope Pal.
Yeah.
Weather is very unpredictable. It can come a flood one night and then it can go a month without any rain. Hot! Yeah. I worked in it. You look at these pictures up here, you know, I look like an Egyptian with that thing on top of my head. Keep the sun burning my brain up. I don't have much in there.
I agree.
But I can work circles around just about anybody.
Yeah.
You know why I want to go to Africa? Because I knew it's going to please God.
Amen.
You know why I give permission? Because I know it pleases God.
Amen.
Because I can't see where my... I can't go to Africa and see that money, that building. I might get a picture of it. One of these days, glory to God. One of these days, I'm going to get to see them people. And I'm going to walk up to my heavenly Father. He ain't going to have to say a word. Are y'all listening to me?
Praise
one of these days, I'm going to get to see my heavenly Father. I hadn't ever seen him before.
Yeah.
Are y'all listening to me?
Yeah.
I've never seen God the Father. One of these days, I'm going to get to see him.
Yeah.
I'm going to get to see him. And you know what I want him to tell me? Well, Lord, you really love my dream. I'm so happy for you. I'm so proud of you. Well done. Come on in.
That's right.
And then all that people inside here that we helped.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Sometimes that dream I had or whatever it was, I felt just a tad. You know, some of the joy, most of the joy that we have in heaven, this area, is going to be them kids we feed.
Yeah.
What God said about it, you just give up. Come and walk. Just to give a cup of water in my name, he given. Jesus said, if you receive one of these little children on that band in my name, Jesus is getting on there with them.
Praise the Lord.
That ought to make them shout right
praise
there.
Praise
the Lord. Every Sunday, you pick them little kids up. Jesus said, every time one of them gets on, I'm getting up there with them.
What?
Guess what? Jesus loved the little children.
Yes,
he said, shuffle the little children. Man, we seen little, Miss Teresa got to see some of these pictures of little kids over there in Africa and loved her. And come, I was working, she was playing a kid. I really, she was sweating bullets, too. Washing clothes, cleaning up the house, but she got the pads, too, with a little kid. One of them named Luke, one of them named Joshua. She was missing her boys here.
Yeah.
God said, I'm going to prove myself. See? In that way, a little way, but God, listen to me. God has a dream. Are we going to help him?
Amen.
Are we going to help God fulfill his dream?
Amen.
Would you let his dream be your dream?
Yeah.
Would you help God get some people out of the field of nightmares?
Yes.
And let them see the people. These people over here, they have a dream. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8 says, who will go for us?
Yeah.
Amen. When I went to the first mission trip I went to, I never heard of Guatemala. I didn't know what that was. Okay? I didn't know what a Guatemala was, never heard of. But when a missionary said, Guatemala, it's like them words blew up to the size of the wall. Guatemala. 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 And God said, you go. I said, okay. One of the most blessed things I ever did in my life. While I was gone, I missed my wife and kids. But while I was there, God gave me a little girl named Veralda. She loved me. I don't know why. I kept looking up. I'd be laying blocks. She'd go there looking. She couldn't talk. She had a
traumatic experience.
Shock. Her dad got killed by guerrillas in guerrilla warfare. She was in shock. She never had spoke a word. But I'd look up, she'd be standing there smiling at me. So one day I went over to her, she was about 8 years old. Little Guatemala paralysis. One of these days I'm gonna see it again. She's probably about 35, 40 years old.
But
God gave me that. Then when I left, I cried like a baby. Then God let me go back the next year with my wife. And there she was, sitting on the back pew of that church in a little, on a piece of board, and she turned around and seen me. Here she comes. You know that was worth it. You know how much that was worth it? I can't put it. There ain't no number I can put on. She loved on my wife, and then we had to leave here.
Yeah.
I'll never forget that little girl. One day I'm going to see her.
Amen.
She'll be talking. Right, hurry! This year comes. Woo! I made it in.
Yeah.
You came up here and built the church, bro. We built the church up on top of a hill up there so they could get out of the weather.
Amen.
That's the thing I'm looking for when I get to heaven. What you guys look for?
Amen.
It ain't just about how glorious heaven's going to be. It's going to be about how many people did we help get there. How many people did we give up what we wanted to see them get what they needed?
Yeah.
Huh? It's called sacrifice.
Yeah.
Oh, that's bad. Oh, that's a tough word in the church today. I thought it was supposed to be prosperity.
Yeah.
Yeah. Almost here. There's a scripture, John chapter 12, I'll quote it. For the corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit.
Yeah.
That God, Jesus is telling us that not only did he die, if Jesus hadn't died on the cross, Brother Bilbo, he said he talked about corn.
That's right.
That don't die, it won't bear fruit. Hello?
Yeah.
Amen. Y'all ever seen the movie Field of Dreams? This is what quickened me to Field of Dreams.
Uh-huh.
And then the Holy Ghost began to just one thing after another. As I prayed, he gave me more than I could ever preach up here today. But in the Field of Dreams, I saw this movie 25 years ago. How many of you have seen it? One of them. Two. Three. In this movie, Bill, I had no idea, Miss Harris, that God was going to use this movie. When I said, Lord, you want me to go, what is it about? You keep saying you're green. So I go get on the internet. I couldn't even remember what it was about. Saw it one time. And this man, it was Kevin Costner, but I can't even remember what his name was, Ray. In the movie, his name was Ray. But when I hit on it, it said this is the most powerful Christian movie there is.
Wow.
I said, what? It said it's the most powerful, number one rated, non-Christian movie that is a Christian parable. I said, you got to be kidding. This is what you want me to see. Woo.
Wow.
My. You got to look at this movie in the spiritual. This man named Ray, he's got a cornfield. Y'all with me? He makes his living raising corn. He got a huge corn field and he gets paid.
Yeah.
That's how he makes his living. Corn. Nothing else. He don't have a sideline. He didn't work no lawn mower or mow grass. He did corn. He's out there in the corn field one day and a voice whispered to him and said, if you build it, he will come.
Wow.
All they hear. He said, if you build it, he will come. And he said, build what?
Yeah.
And he struggled with that. Build what? He said, a ball field. A baseball field.
Yeah.
A baseball field out here in the middle of nowhere in a cornfield. His wife even said, he told his wife, I just heard a small voice. We hear a still small voice sometimes, right? Who is that talking to?
Jesus.
That's why this movie relates. And he said, this boy said, if I build it, they will come. He will come.
They will come.
In the movie, he said, he. I heard that.
That is the movie.
He says he. Whatever.
Yeah, come on.
When you hear who came, then you'll know. This guy, God told him to build a ball field. He said, give up my livelihood. You want my corn to die?
Yeah.
All he hears. You want me to give up my corn? That's how I make my living. What's it? Who is it? He didn't say it was God. He just said a voice. But to us, the voice of God. If we build it, he'll come. if we build a bell pillar. But in the movie, he starts, everybody thinks he's crazy. He's lost his mind. But what he didn't realize was who was coming. He thought Brother Keenan that he was going to get to play ball. But what he didn't know was there was some ball players back in 1919, as y'all listen to me, that had a dream of playing in the World Series, and it did, that dream wasn't fulfilled. One of them, name was Shoeless Joe Jackson.
Oh, yeah.
Remember that? So, in the movie, this voice wants Kevin Costner to build a ball field so these men's dreams could be fulfilled.
Amen.
Even though he wasn't going to get one down far, he thought. Yeah. Are y'all listening to him? He couldn't see the end of it. He didn't know what was coming, but he obeyed the voice.
He trusted.
When he was here, he knew that whatever this voice was, he didn't say it was God. Okay? It wasn't a Christian movie, but I'm telling you, the message in this movie is gripped me. I never saw it when I watched the movie. But this week, all week, it's just been. Man, he tears his cornfield down. His livelihood and builds us even best.
Wow.
He had to invest in light poles. He had lights. He built this ball field and now he's waiting for whomever is supposed to come. Then one day he's out there. Guess who comes out of what's left of his cornfield? They start walking out on the field. Now listen. From the way back in the past. These guys start walking out. They wanted to play with Chicago White Sox. His father had a vision.
Yeah.
Man, that's right.
His father had a vision of playing with the Chicago White Sox.
Wow.
His dad.
Yeah.
Who he never really got to know, he died. Okay? I don't say when he died, but he never had a good relationship with his daddy. But his daddy, one of his dream was to play with the Chicago White Sox.
That's right.
So he don't get to play. They choose up out there. These guys, they come out of the corn and everything. I mean, there's some mysticism to it, but if you look at it in the spiritual, see, that's why it's rated the number one parable movie there ever has been created.
Yeah.
Because some people saw the mission then.
Yeah.
Because I asked the computer, I said, what did the Field of Dreams have to do with missions? I knew it had to have something to do with missions because God told me to go watch.
Yeah.
So, these guys, they get to play ball now. They got kicked out of the World Series because something happened. They either got accused of throwing a game or something and just shut it down. But these guys, their dream of playing in the World Series was never fulfilled.
Yeah.
And his dad, see, wanted to be a White Sox player.
Yeah.
From a kid. So he's up there and he got bleachers all around. He bought bleachers.
Yep. He got a whole setup.
He invested.
Yeah.
He invested in a dream that was somebody else's dream.
Yeah.
Amen. Y'all hear me today.
Yeah.
He invested money. He took money out. He not only gave up his livelihood. I'm not asking anybody to do that. I don't think God is. But he gave up. He sacrificed something. A corn of wheat fell into the ground. That corn died.
Yeah.
And this man here, he's a ball player, and he don't get to play. He gets to sit up in bleachers and he was mad.
Yeah.
Kevin Costner, the guy Ray.
Yeah.
He was upset. I thought I was going to get to play. We won't ever get to see that, bro.
Yeah, that's right.
You're not ever going to get to see them people shout. We might. I don't know. But time is sharp.
Yes.
It's sharp.
Yes.
Some of these people might get saved during the tribulation period.
I'm not.
Yeah.
And y'all listen to me.
Amen.
Your dollars are going to mean, if you look at it the way God wants you to look at it, your dollars is going to mean souls.
Amen.
The easiest way, and I've said this for years, the easiest way to be a soul winner is to give to missions.
Yeah.
If you don't never win another soul, I've won way more souls giving to missions than I ever won myself.
Amen. That's right.
I can promise you, and I ain't never seen none of them.
Yeah.
But I know that my dollars went to me.
Yeah.
Our tax lady back when we was in business, they said, y'all crazy. Y'all giving all this money to missions. What in the world? She didn't have a clue why we was giving money to missions like that. Oh. Ball player, Ray, is farming. Remember, he's a farmer.
Yeah.
He plays.
That's right.
Yeah.
Playing. And reaps.
Yeah.
He don't get to play. He's mad. Then one day, the ball game's over. The guys go back in the corner.
Yeah.
There's this one guy left out.
Come on now.
He's a catcher. You remember that?
Yes.
That little bat. This may be God's movie. I didn't see. I don't even remember this, but he's the catcher and he got on the mound. And that boy, Ray's been watching his catcher all week, but he never got to see his face.
Yeah.
So he, this catcher invites him to come on down.
Yeah.
They out there. Oh, man. Guess who the catcher was?
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
Jesus Christ.
The father.
Yeah. And he knew. And his father was now a young man. He was young.
Yeah.
I can't even remember in the movie if he knew who he was because he was so young, but he said they embraced. It's like it's gonna be in heaven. You know, we can't see our heavenly Father right now. But if we'll just do what He wants us to do, one day we'll get to see Him.
Amen.
We can't see Him now. By faith we see Him though. I go to another city. I got a city that's not here. It's in the heaven. And one of these days I'm gonna go and see that city. And guess who's gonna be in there? My heavenly Father.
Yeah.
While I prayed this week, I was thinking about that movie. And I said, Father, I can't wait to see you. Someday that veil is going to be removed and I'm going to look in your face.
Praise the Lord.
Oh, that's going to be something that's falling. This farmer gets to see his daddy.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
They sitting there talking, you know. And I'm sure old Ray, he's still wondering, how in the world am I going to pay for all this?
Yeah, that's right.
It's getting dark. And he looked out there up the road and here comes cars lighting up.
Play.
Yeah.
I'm talking about as far as the eye can see. Cars coming down the dirt road.
Yep.
Y'all listen to me.
Come on now.
There's people coming to see the ball game that night.
Yeah.
And they're going to pay to get in. Are y'all hearing me today?
Yeah.
So this farmer's dream, it wasn't his dream. He didn't know what was going on. But this farmer, Ray, not only did he get to see his father.
Yeah.
If you build it, that boy said, if you feel it, he'll come.
Amen.
So he did. Against everybody else's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You ever done anything to God? People said, you are out of your mind. Yeah. You can't give that kind of money to God. That's what the devil told me 39 years ago. Well, you don't make $200 a week. How are you going to give God $2,000?
Yeah.
You know what? It happened.
Yeah.
Yes, it did.
It happened. One of these days, I'm going to see them people at that little church. I've never seen the church. Don't have my name on it. It's got Jesus' name on it. That's what I want. One of these days, I'm going to get to see them people, and they're going to come up and say, remember 1979 when you gave money to build it? And the joy.
Yeah.
Can you imagine?
Right.
The joy. And old Ray, you know, he never imagined that all these people. When he tore his cornfield down, all he could think about was what he was giving up.
Yeah.
But then that one day came, and here they come. He realized then, if I build, not only will he come, those people are gone.
That's right.
If I lose a scripture in the Bible in John 16 about our money, how we use our money, will be rewarded in heaven. How unrighteous man. Your money, even though money is used for evil things, ain't all about money. What it'll do, what your money will do, what about your money has power.
Yes,
it does.
If you use it in the right way, it has more power than you could ever comprehend.
That's right.
That's right.
I just want you, all of you, and Lowe. I love all of you. I appreciate you coming and being part of this. I hope you've been praying. But I want you to understand, once again, faith is not what you can see. Okay? Not what you can see, it's what God sees that you can't see. And you tell the Lord by coming down here today. If you don't want to give, don't just stay in your seat. The Bible says God wants people that give willingly.
Yeah.
Not grudgingly. Because if you give, listen to me. Bible says to whom much, if you give generously, you'll be blessed. But if you give sparingly, your blessings are going to be sparingly. I'm asking today, God's asking everybody in this church, adults that work and make money, all of you have been blessed. I don't like to let all of you testify. You tell me where you was 10 years ago, where you are now. I could. But I want us to come. Miss Tiffany's going to play some music. There's some pieces of paper up here on the pulpit, on the altar. I want you to come up here and talk. Pray first.
Yeah.
Don't come now. I don't want, man. God, look what I got. This is faith. Don't look at nothing around you. That song they sang a while ago. With God, impossible becomes possible. We gonna get any banners or any? They gonna have a parade for us in Africa?
No.
We get to heaven though.
Amen.
How many of you do it just to see one? If you knew one soul was gonna miss hell.
Amen.
If you knew one soul was gonna miss hell because you gave the sinner guy, how much it's gonna be more than one? I promise you that.
Amen.
It's gonna be multitudes get saved, and it's gonna be hundreds. It's gonna have a building, maybe thousands. Think you'd be amazed how many people they cram them into a little. They ain't worried about pews.
Yeah.
Comfort. They come to worship God.
Amen.
And I want us Hope House today to invest in the kingdom of God. I want us to give back. What can we render unto God for all his been? I think about all the blessings Hope House has been blessed. We've never had to pay a note on a bill. We ain't never paid a note on a bank.
Yeah.
Somebody gave it to us.
Amen.
Aldridge wrote, go ahead, Miss Tim. Write, you don't have to sign your name. We need $10,000 by November 1st. You got 6 months. You put on this, you sign your amount, and you say, God, this is what I want you to help me give by November the 1st. If you provide it, God, I'm going to give it. If you don't provide it, I won't get 6 months. How much money do we waste? I'm not going to give God a waste. No! I want us to give God above what we think we're able to give. Amen? If just 10 people gave $1,000, if 10 families, if that's all we had, I know it's going to be some that's going to do more than that, but that ain't a lot of money, Hope House. Where's our faith? God has a dream. God has a dream, LaSalle. Martinette, Demetrius, Bill Bow, Luke, Brother Walker, Brother Jarvis, God has a dream. Brother Gary, God has a dream. That nobody perish. We know that some people are going to perish, but what are we going to do about the ones we can help? We can't save everybody, but we can help God. We can give God today and trust God to help us. I promise you, the testimonies that will come out of this after November the 1st will blow your own mind. Step out. Just step out and say, God, I'm going to do this. Will you help me? Will you provide this money, God? Oh, Hope House, the lives we can touch. The lives we can touch. You get through praying. You pray as long as you need to. Probably some of us need to pray longer. You write that map down there. If you want to lift it, that's up to you. We're going to take them up. Whether we got that much or not, I'm going to call that missionary tomorrow and tell him we got some. We trust in God, $10,000. Thank the Lord. I've had people contact me, don't even go to this church. They want to be part of it.
Amen.
I was hoping about it too. I don't want to keep nobody from blessing. We're going to do this thing sometimes, not by life.